Now it's time for another Board Game Brawl preview with Nick Minahan, sponsored by BoardGameBliss.com. Hey now folks, my name is Nick, this is Board Game Brawl, and today we're going to be taking a look at a game that is currently seeking funding on Kickstarter. That game is called Kumite, and it's from Fifth Dimension Games. Now if you like what you see throughout the rest of this preview video, I'm going to encourage you to go to the official Kickstarter project page. I'll have a link at the bottom of your screen now, and at the end of the video, and also down in the description section of the video, that will take you to the official Kickstarter page. You can find out more information and hopefully consider backing the project. Kumite is a one-on-one, head-to-head game. Each player takes control of a different martial artist using a different style of martial arts, from boxing to Muay Thai, kickboxing to Taekwondo, and even more. You are trying to edge out your opponent using your specific fighting style, and you're doing it with mechanisms similar to deck building in a sense, because you're getting new skills as you go through different matches, trying to reduce your opponent down to zero hit points, and using experience points to get those new skills. Let me go ahead and give you a brief look at how the game is played with a prototype version of the game, so some things may change in the final version. Then we're going to come back. I'll let you know my final thoughts. Alright, I'm going to run you through a game of Kumite. This is a competitive game for two players. The goal is to knock out your opponent by reducing their hit points to zero. Each player is going to have a set of cards here. One of them is a hit point card. One of them is an experience card. You will use the experience card to cover up the hit point card and put yourself at the appropriate amount of hit points. Each player starts off at 10 hit points. You want to knock your opponent's number down to zero. As you gain experience points, you'll keep the card in the same position to keep track of your hit points. You'll just rotate this card around, and this one actually goes around to a up to 7 total experience points, which is the maximum that you can have. Now, each player in the game is going to have a different martial artist with a different type of martial arts style. So the two decks that I have laid out here for this example is the boxing deck. So you have a boxing character card here and the little blurb about the origins of boxing on the back of it. And then the other character deck that I'm using is the Muay Thai, I'm sorry for mispronouncing that, Muay Thai boxing, kickboxing style, which again with the blurb on the back. So you'll put those two character cards out in the center of the table, and they're going to be on either sides of these mat cards. Now, the mat cards, just before you start the game, can also function as cheat sheets for the game as well, telling you the actions you can perform in the turn order. But you'll lay out the 7 mat cards like this, and you'll put the fighters at opposite ends. Also, each different fighting style is going to have these skill cards that are going to be divided into different colors of belts. So you'll have the blue belt cards, the brown belt cards, and the black belt cards, and you will actually start off with the 3 white belt cards in hand. And all these skill cards should be visible to the other player in order for them to read the cards and determine what your potential abilities are going to be. But you do not start off with these. You have to use your experience points in order to gain them. Each card has a couple of notches, signifying the actual notches in real life that the belts would have. And you'll have to use your experience points, whatever the number is of notches, in order to acquire those cards. You also have to build up from top to bottom. So for instance, you start off with white belt cards, so therefore you can go ahead and purchase blue cards right away. But in order to get the brown belt card, you have to have already purchased blue belt cards. Same thing with black belts. In order to get that, you have to get brown belt cards. Now as I go through the rest of the rules in more detail, I'll explain that it's possible for you to return cards that you've previously purchased back to your dojo back to the skill card area in order to draw other cards more efficiently. But even if you return cards, you can still meet the prerequisites to get to a future card. So even if you got rid of every one of your blue cards and put them back on the table, you'd still be able to get brown cards. And then if you've had all the brown cards, you'll be able to get black cards eventually anyways. You'll never lose the capabilities to purchase those. I should also mention as well that even though it's beyond the scope of this particular preview, there are 2 other types of martial arts styles that will come in the base game. You have Taekwondo and Karate. And now these have their own decks, their own different fighting styles, their own unique skill cards. But we're just going to focus on Muay Thai and boxing for this preview. All right, so let me take you through how the game is going to work. First off, at the beginning of the game, you're going to randomly determine who is going to go first. Whoever is not going first, the second player, in other words, gets to start off with one bonus XP. Again, you just rotate the card to show the XP that you're gaining. On your turn, there's many different things that you can do, but you are limited to 4 stamina. Stamina is something like action points. So once you've used up all of your stamina, you are done for the turn, and you must use all of that stamina. So for instance, one of the basic moves that you can do is simply moving. So when you decide to move, you're going to take your character card, and for every space that you want to move, you must spend 1 stamina. So at the beginning of the game, I can just go ahead and say, I'm going to move forward 2 spaces. That is 2 of my stamina, and now I can use the other 2 stamina for something else. If I really want to, I can use all 4 of my stamina and go that many spaces forward. The next type of action you can take is simply to gain experience points. For every stamina that you spend, you get to gain an experience point. Now, this is where I'll also mention that there are certain actions, including the experience action, that you can't just do on their own on your turn. So I couldn't just use all 4 of my stamina in order to gain 4 experience points. I would have had to do one of the other basic movement or skill actions. So in other words, moving, playing a skill card, standing up, breaking a hold, or becoming unstunned. As long as I do at least one of those, I can take one of the other actions that revolve around getting experience points, spending experience points, or manipulating and returning skill cards and such. Speaking of those skill cards, one of the other actions that I can do is play one of my skill cards using stamina. Now, the stamina cost for these skill cards is going to be different depending on the card. So, for instance, I have jab and leg kicks in my white belt cards that I start off with. Those each cost me 1 stamina. But when you get into the higher level cards, for instance, this blue belt card cross cost me 2 stamina, whereas I go all the way up to the black belt cards and roundhouse is going to cost me 3 stamina. So you have to be aware of what your cards are going to cost you. But let's go into these cards in a little more detail. So here we have, again, this is the experience points for the card, although these are the white belt cards, so you'll start with these, and the color, the name. And then you have the stamina, which I already covered, is how many action points essentially you have to spend to do that. Then you have movement. Now, some cards require that you move before you can take the action. And when you do so, you have to move right away unless a card says otherwise. But this is not always the case. So, for instance, all of the cards for the Muay Thai boxer are actually 0 movement, so you don't have to worry about that. Then you have range. The range is how far away you can be from your opponent for the attack to actually be successful. So the jab here is a range of 1. Now, a range of 1 regarding the playmats would actually be being physically 1 space away from your opponent on opposite sides. So in this particular case, I am 1 space away from my opponent. You have to picture that they're both on the mats, not literally on other sides of it, of this gulf here. If both players' cards were directly opposite each other, that would be a range of 0, and so on and so forth. Now, going back to the cards and the stats on the bottom, the last one you see there is strength. Now, strength is just straight up how much damage you can do to your opponent. Now, in response to any kind of damage that you or your opponent takes, you can try to use defense cards. Defense cards have a D in place of the stamina number, and that's because they don't cost you any stamina, and also you must play them on your opponent's turn, because obviously you are blocking your opponent's attacks when they do them to you. And they will also have potentially movement and also range, meaning like how far away you can be to actually use the card and prevent the damage, and then in the text box, it will tell you how much damage that is going to prevent. So in the case of this, the white belt block is going to prevent 1 damage that your opponent is potentially giving to you. If you can block every single bit of damage that is coming at you, you take no damage, obviously. But if any damage gets through, even if you're able to prevent some of it, you are going to take the remaining damage off of your hit points on your card, keeping the orientation of your skill card wherever that happened to be. Now let's just take a look at a few more of the, just as an example, I'll show you some more of the Muay Thai cards. I'm not going to go into all the different cards of all the different styles, but I just want to give you an example of how cards can escalate in power as you go forward. So in other words, one of the blue belt cards here, the Thai clinch, has a stamina of 1. It doesn't do any damage, or, you know, it has a range of 0, which you might think is not that great, but you notice that in the text box it says that it is a hold. A hold is a type of attack in this game. You have to be at range 0 to do it, and you will physically hold your opponent down, meaning that they cannot use skill cards so long as he is held. Now, if you do anything else, like using your skills or anything like that, or something, your opponent plays some sort of card that gets them out of a hold, then the hold is going to be ended. Also, one of the actions you can take on this game using stamina, in this case, one stamina, is breaking an opponent's hold. But you are at least locking down your opponent temporarily and forcing them to waste their stamina in order to do that. Going down to the brown belt cards, you see that we have another defense card here, the Tie Block, which is going to cost you 2 experience points. This is another defense card. It's usable at a range of 1 or 2. You prevent up to 2 damage, or you can prevent stun. Stun is another type of special effect you can inflict on your opponent, which again will prevent them from using actions. And just like with the hold, you have to spend the stamina just to become unstunned. But at least the Tie Block could potentially prevent that from happening in the first place. It can also be used against holds or takedowns. Takedowns are another effect. Takedowns are even worse because when you are taken down, you have to stand up on your turn. In order to do that, you have to spend 2 stamina. And then I'll just go ahead and show you the black belt cards here. You have a roundhouse, which does indeed inflict stun. You see it deals 2 damage, but it does cost you 3 stamina. And the switch kick, which cannot be blocked by the basic block that every character has. It just rips right through that thing. I'll also mention that just from the mat standpoint, the stun, takedown, and hold has different appearances on the map. If someone is stunned, they have to turn their character card to the side. If someone is in the middle of performing a hold maneuver, you'll actually overlap the cards onto the mat, showing that one player is holding the other. And if you just do a takedown, like let's say I'm taking down, I do a takedown on my boxing opponent here, you will just put their card on the mat by themselves, showing that they've been thrown down to the mat. And as I said, they can't use skill cards while any of these effects are taking place, and they can't move either until they become un-whatever it is. Now, the thing about the skill cards are, when you use skill cards, or at the end of your turn, if you have any cards that you've played or that you have left in hand, they're immediately going to be discarded. Now, after that happens, you will, if you have no cards in your deck, which at the start of the game, you have no deck, then you're going to reshuffle your discard pile and draw 3 cards, or draw as many as you possibly can. Now, what's going to happen is, as you buy these skill cards, you get to add them into your hand. They will be used and then they'll go into your deck. So there's a bit of deck building going on. So remember, you're spending the XP cost of the cards to put them into your hand, or you can actually spend XP to put a card from your hand back into your dojo. This is typical deck building stuff where you might want to thin out cards that you don't personally find very useful anymore, and so that you may draw your better cards faster. Now, once you have a deck going on, and let's say it's your turn and you have your 3 cards in hand, but you really, really want to put more cards into your hand, one of the other actions that you can take is actually to spend the stamina to, spend an experience point, which is even worse, because that's a much more valuable resource, in order to draw a card from your deck. So you'll be able to gain access to that right away. You can also, let's say that you have a card that you don't have the stamina to use right now, or you think will be better on a later turn, you can spend both a stamina and an experience point in order to take a card that's currently in your hand and put it back on top of the deck. Because even if you don't use the cards on your turn that you have in your hand, they're going to be discarded no matter what. So you might want to save that card, put it on top of your deck in order to make sure that you draw it right away. And then as far as the other remaining actions, they're just the becoming unstunned, becoming untakedowned, and also breaking your opponent's hold. These things cost either 1 stamina for holds or stuns, or 2 stamina for standing up. And that is really the game. It's fast and furious, much more so than probably I gave the indication of here. You're playing your attack cards on your turn and hoping your opponent does not block against them in order to deal as much damage as possible, stunning, taking down, using holds if you need to, in order to reduce your opponent's hit points to 0. The first person to do that, or to first force your opponent to concede, is going to be the winner of the game. That is Kumite. Now, let's get to my final thoughts. The theme of Kumite comes across very well, because not only are you just playing cards from your hand, but you're also physically manipulating these different characters out amongst these mat cards. So you're moving back and forth, just jockeying back and forth for position, attacking, using using your special skills and whatever range they may happen to have, pinning your opponent down to the mat, throwing them down, all these different things that really give a good thematic feel to how an actual martial arts match would happen. Then you add in the different skill cards and the deck building mechanism. Deck building sort of a loose thing here, but it is used in a unique way because you have access to all of your different cards at the beginning. It's just a matter of you going through the different levels, working your way up from you start with the white belt, then you go to the brown or blue, then brown, then black, which again is a thematic aspect of the game that is true to life. But you work your way through this chain of moves, utilizing the ones that you really want, potentially getting rid of the ones that no longer seem very useful to you anymore, and then using them against your opponent. The whole aspect of blocking when you can, and sometimes having to make sure to use your precious stamina and even experience points potentially to stack the deck, to either draw more cards from the deck when you need them the most, or to put cards that you can't really use right now, but you may need to use them on the next turn. So go ahead and put them on top of your deck. These things take precious resources, and it may not seem immediately obvious why you would want to do that. But this, again, is a thematic aspect of the game, because in real-life combat situations, whether they are formal or not, you sometimes have to make sacrifices. You may have to sacrifice a bit of, take a hit, or sacrifice a bit of your speed and position in order to come out over top of your opponent with your next move, to put yourself in a more favorable position for the next maneuver that you want to do. So all these different aspects really work in favor of Kumite to actually give that broad thematic appeal. And by the way, when I mention all these things, I really have to emphasize that this is a fast game. It's a very easy game to learn. You'll be up and running in 5 to 10 minutes at the most. And then after your first game, you'll be like, okay, I got this. Now I can start to explore all these different strategies and tactics. It's a very tactical game, while at the same time, because of the quote-unquote deck building, working your way through the skill cards, that is where the strategy comes in. How do I want to build my deck? How do I want to weed out my deck? What do I need to have in my deck, and when do I need to draw them in order to make the best use, in order to come out on top in this match? And also, what do I need to do to counter my opponent's moves when they happen? And that's where the blocking really gets interesting as well. Do you even care about blocking that much? Do you just want to go full out on offensive and hope that that works out for you? There's all these different decisions that you have to make during the game, despite the fact that it is a very fast and very easy to learn game, and therefore really accessible to a wide variety of gamers, both experienced gamers, but also casual gamers as well. And in the final version, you know, with the artwork that they have, when everything is finalized, it'll also be an attractive game too. So if this sounds like it's something that appeals to you, if you're looking for that fast and furious head-to-head game without like a collectible aspect, and with just having that martial art, real world martial arts feel without any kind of fantastical elements that might be going into the absurd territory, then you should definitely check out Kumite, because there's not a lot of other products out there like this right now in the gaming market. I'm going to have a link at the bottom of your screen now, and then down in the description section of the video, that's going to take you to the official Kickstarter project page. Find out more information, don't take my word for it, and hopefully consider backing the project. That is Kumite from Fifth Dimension Games. Check it out. Thank you so much for watching, and take care. Thanks for watching. Follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and Patreon. And make sure to check out our sponsor, Board Game Bliss, where you can find an amazing selection of games from around the world. BoardGameBliss.com. Thanks for your support.